Hello and welcome. You are listening to a podcast by the Milner Centre for Evolution at the University of Bath. I'm Professor Turi King, your host, and today I'm talking to Jonathan Milner, founder of the Milner Centre for Evolution, about his passion for science and evolution in particular. Jonathan, these days you're a highly successful businessman. You founded the biotech company Abcam, and you've gone on to become an entrepreneur and a business leader. But you didn't start out in business. You started out in genetics. So tell me about your growing up and kind of what led to your interest in that field.
Well, it all started, I suppose, at Portsmouth Grammar School. And there I was really interested in science. So I did biology, chemistry, physics at A level. But biology was a mystery to me until I had this one lesson from a teacher, Dr. Nick Knight. And he said, I'm going to tell you about evolution. And immediately the whole of what I couldn't understand about biology all clicked. And I thought, gosh, this is it, isn't it? This is really the basis of the whole of biology. And I started to really love the subject. So I thought, do you know what, I'm going to do this. So I applied to Bath University, got into Bath University to apply biology. And then my fascination for evolution just grew and grew. And then Professor Paul Nurse, when he was right at the beginning of his career, came and gave a talk about the cell cycle and yeast and how that was related to the human genes, the homologs that he discovered and got the Nobel Prize for. So he inspired me, and I thought, well, I'm going to do a PhD. And that got me thinking again more and more about evolution. And the whole of my research, it just all came back down to what's going on at an evolutionary level. But then I became worried and a little bit disillusioned that not only do the public not really understand or pay much attention to the theory of evolution, but it's also misunderstood within science as well. And it's not given central place in anything that we do in biological research, whether that's in medicine or fundamental research into the cell cycle, cancer, etc., you name it. So this is what triggered my love of evolution, which has gone on a whole lifetime.
So that's really interesting, because this was going to be one of my questions. Was there something that kind of triggered it? And it sounds like something that was. Do you remember what was in that lesson? Was it just like a basic lesson about evolution? Or was there something that he was teaching that made you kind of really go, yeah, actually, that completely makes sense to me?
Do you know what there was? So we'd already done genetics. So we had the DNA and the hereditary thing. But nobody really understood about evolution. And then when Nick was going on about, look, it's very simple. You've just got to have variation, your selection, and your descent into the next generation. You've only got three things. I thought, oh, hang on a minute. This is weird. But then when it clicked, it went just like that. And Darwin himself said it's a strange inversion of logic, which it is. You know, how can you get complexity out of simplicity? Well, you can if you've got those three components, and you can put those three components into anything. It doesn't have to be into biology. You can apply this theory and you will get complexity out of simplicity.
So Nick sounds like a great guy, just to kind of put it down into those three different components.
That's right. And this is why I'm passionate about making sure that teachers know how to teach it like Nick taught it, because otherwise I might not have gone into biology and, you know, missed out on all of that. That would be horrible.
So you did applied biology at Bath. So were you already thinking you want to apply it to something?
I'd love to say yes, but the answer is no. It was just simply, I like Bath and I like what I saw when I went to visit, and I thought it would be fun. And I loved the subject. The lecturers were great. It was a fabulous course and I just really, really enjoyed it.
What did you do for your PhD then?
So one of the placements was at the Leicester Biocentre. And then I decided to do my PhD in fungal genetics. So I accepted a position at University of Leicester working on a very obscure bacterium called Awinia amylovera. So my PhD was called A Molecular Genetic Analysis of Awinia amylovera, which is a pathogen which causes fire blight in pear and apple trees. Sounds awful, but actually, for me, it was just really interesting and I loved every minute of it.
And then didn't you go back to Bath and do your postdoc at Bath? Did I read that right?
Yeah. One, I wanted to go back to Bath, but two, there was a really interesting project came up, and that was a collaboration between Professor Tony Rees's laboratory at Bath University with Pfizer down in Sandwich in Kent. And this was looking at antibody engineering. And I was fascinated by antibody engineering. Again, it all comes back down to evolution. You know, that's how the immune system works, through a process of evolution. So I got fascinated by antibodies and started this project. And yeah, had a wonderful time between Bath University and the Pfizer site down at Sandwich, which sadly they've closed now, but anyway.
So for anyone who doesn't know what an antibody is, talk us through what antibodies are.
So antibodies are one of the most incredible molecules in the world, and we would be dead very quickly if we didn't have them circulating inside us, because their primary purpose is to root out pathogens and mark them for destruction from our immune system. And that's happening every second of the day, all day long. So without antibodies, we would be really dead. So they're incredibly important molecules. Yeah. And then the wonderful thing was that scientists found out in the 70s how to make these antibodies called monoclonal antibodies, where you can actually take one type of antibody with one specific sequence that locks onto one specific target. And that's completely revolutionized the whole of research, through drug discovery to therapeutics. So there's quite a few antibody drugs now. So yeah, they are incredible molecules.
So how did antibodies start to become a part of your scientific research and then later your career?
Yeah, so then my next project, I ended up in the mid-90s taking a postdoc at the University of Cambridge in Professor Tony Kouzourides' laboratory. And we were looking at the breast cancer genes that had newly been discovered. So these are BRCA1 and BRCA2, which are involved with hereditary breast cancer. So the genes have been discovered, but genes make proteins. And proteins have got a function within our cells. So we're made up of trillions of cells. And inside of each of those cells, the little components that actually make everything work are called proteins. And they buzz around doing incredible things. And they're encoded by the genes. So we had the gene, but we didn't know what the protein was doing. So you can't see these proteins because, you know, trying to get inside a cell and seeing what's going on is just not possible. But what you can do is you can say, okay, well, I've got this protein and I want to see what it's doing and how it's behaving inside a cell. How can I do that? Well, I can make an antibody to it, I can label it, and then I can track it through the cell. I can see what's happening, what it's interacting with, what are the pathways, what is its function. And so we started to do that. But fundamental to it was, the first thing to do was to say, hey, make antibodies. Once you've got antibodies, then you can do all of this incredible research. But without the antibodies, you can't.
So you're using antibodies and you're trying to understand the genetic basis of breast cancer and what's going on there. Did you think you were just going to keep going and be like an academic scientist? Because you're a hugely successful businessman. Were you already thinking that way? Or did you think, oh, for the rest of my life, I am going to be an academic scientist?
It was definitely not a, oh, you know, I'm going to be a businessman. It was a day in the lab, and I can remember it quite well, actually. And I would describe it as an entrepreneurial seizure. And this was because I was getting so frustrated that I couldn't find the right antibodies. So you can actually buy these antibodies off the shelf in a little tube, and you can put them into your research. So I was ordering these antibodies for my breast cancer protein to try and get my breast cancer research to move forward. And these antibodies were not very good. And then just one day I said, this is silly. It was in 1998. And I turned to my colleague, Luke Hughes Davis, and I said, Luke, I said, this is crazy. You know, why don't we start a company where we can produce much better antibodies than these? And once I'd got this entrepreneurial seizure in my head, I couldn't let go of it. And then I discovered this website that nobody was using and nobody had heard of, where you could go onto this website and I could order a book, and the book would come and be delivered to your house. And okay, it might take 2 or 3 days, but I didn't care. I didn't want to trek into town. So I was one of the first users of Amazon, and I thought, hang on a minute, this is crazy. I should be able to just go to a website, select the exact antibody that I want for my research, and then have that delivered, and I can start using it immediately without all of these problems that I've been experiencing. And so that was the genesis of the idea.
And it's been a hugely successful business. You have helped scientists around the world doing their research by developing this. And it's put you in this wonderful position because you are now able to use the money that you've got to fund passions and growth in other companies. So what are you doing at the moment? What are things that are really exciting you?
Well, I'm doing a lot in drug discovery and a lot in rare disease. So I work with a wonderful company called Helix, which repurposes drugs for rare disease. And that's terrifically exciting. And I've got various other projects in loads of different companies, all mainly in life sciences across antibodies, drug discovery, you name it. But really, you're right. Anything that really interests me, I'm in this incredible position where I can, you know, put my resources behind that company and help them with also my experience. And I love it. Yeah.
I was going to say that must be so wonderful to go, actually, this looks really interesting and I'd like to be able to support that. And you must get to hear quite early on about some of the new ideas that are coming out.
Yeah, it's wonderful because I don't have to try that hard because ideas come to me. So a few years ago, three wonderful guys just done their PhDs, came out of Cambridge. They came to me and said, we've got this great idea for a company. So it started off synthesizing DNA. They pivoted to make a machine which can synthesize proteins in a way where you can select the best conditions for making proteins. And that sounds, you know, well, what do you want to do that for? Well, we've already discussed that proteins are the fundamental building blocks of the cell. And if you're going to do any drug discovery, any sort of research, you've got to be able to isolate your protein. And to do that, you've got to be able to express it. Anyway, they've got this machine. The company's called Nuclera. I'll give it a plug. And they're wonderful guys. And they're launching a machine, the e-protein platform. And it can do 192 reactions at one time in 2 days, which would take previously me 2 years to do, at least, you know, on one little cassette, on one little machine. So things like that, you know, is all coming through. And it's the most exciting time to be involved with biology, with all these wonderful things that you can do now.
So what prompted you to start the Milner Centre for Evolution at the University of Bath?
Well, that came out of a conversation with Professor Lawrence Hurst. And we were talking about our passion for evolution. And then I think I just said, well, wouldn't it be wonderful to do this? And Lawrence said, yes, let's do it. And then it all snowballed from there.
So what would you like the Milner Centre to do? How would you like it to evolve?
Well, I mentioned that my frustration throughout my entire career, ever since my PhD really, has been that there's this misunderstanding of evolution and it's not applied enough in a way that we can really solve problems that the world faces. And COVID is one of them. We could have solved COVID a lot quicker if we understood what was going on an evolutionary level. And we did eventually, but it was frustrating to see how long it was taking. So this really prompted me to think, well, what should the Centre for Evolution at Bath be doing? And for me, there's two things. One is to be at the cutting edge of evolutionary research. And then secondly, to be able to communicate that research to the wider public and especially to the younger generation. So even kids at primary school, they can grasp the concept of evolution if it's taught properly. So yeah, this is my vision, that the Centre for Evolution should be, you know, one of the best places in the world for evolutionary outreach, thinking, research, but especially on the educational side.
Jonathan, thank you so much for talking with me. This was a podcast by the Milner Centre for Evolution at the University of Bath. I'm Turi King and thank you for listening. If you have any thoughts or comments on this or any other episodes, please contact us via our X channel at Milner Centre. For more information about the Milner Centre for Evolution, you can visit our website.